is Aaron, and I was part of Yard 16's Christmas Carol as Tiny Tim. It was an absolutely awesome experience to work with Jessica Chase, Tom Chase, and Bob Colonna. Hopefully, in the future, I can do it again. Alrighty. I'll see you later. Merry Christmas.
Hi everyone, my name is Angelique Dina, and I did A Christmas Carol from 2015 until 2018. And one of my greatest joys in doing A Christmas Carol was getting to see everyone come into a room together to create and explore human conditions on stage. I have a lot of fond memories, particularly with Megan, Abby, Katrina, and Kyle. We were a cool group. We all didn't do A Christmas Carol every single year, but we tried and continue to support Artist Exchange in different ways. And I am very happy to see that A Christmas Carol will still be getting done, but virtually, because the message still continues and the story still happens.
Hi, my name is Sam Zuckerman. I'm a new face to the Christmas Carols last year, which is 2019. I like all the people I met. You know, I met some familiar faces, some new faces, you know. I played Fred, actually. I think I gave a lot of authenticity, you know, original with the character, like tapping into what his emotions were, like cheerful, happy, excited, and always all about Christmas.
Look at how neat these are. This is the last time ever they will be this neat, even lit. This is the last time these will ever be untangled. Happy holidays. So anyway, make sure you're 6 feet back and I'll take my mask off. Happy holidays, everybody. My name's Jeff White. And I'd like to extend my wishes to the Artist Exchange for a celebration of 16 years of A Christmas Carol. I was honored more than you can imagine on 3 occasions to grace the stage at the Artist Exchange for their annual Christmas Carol, which has become such a tradition in the city of Cranston. I was lucky enough to play Old Joe and the Schoolmaster 1 year. Marley another year, and 1 year I was lucky enough to play Scrooge. And those shows will always be in my memory. It made Christmas what it was supposed to be. We had a snowstorm for one of the shows, and everything turned out magical as it should. So Merry Christmas, everybody. And thank you to the Artist Exchange and everybody over the years who's played a part in their Christmas Carol. I wish you all a happy, happy holiday season. And please, everybody, do your best. Stay safe. And let's wear our masks, okay? I love you. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. Very
good, boy. My name is Deborah Ferrante, and I've been in Christmas Carol since 2011. Last year was the grandfather. When I first started doing it, I did the businessman. And then I also played Old Joe. And of course, I loved working with these different people, doing different different shows and everything. But other than that, I just love doing it. I love it. It's just a lot of fun.
Thank you. Jacob Molly, and I am dead. Oh no, there's no doubt that I am dead. The registry of my burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and by my chief mourner, Ebenezer Scrooge. I am as dead as a doornail. I present him to you, Ebenezer Scrooge, England's most tight-fisted hand at the grindstone. Scrooge, a squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner, secret and self-contained, and solitary as an oyster. The cold within him freezes his old features, nips his pointed nose, shrivels his cheek, stiffens his gait, makes his eyes red, his thin lips blue, and he speaks out shrewdly in his grating voice. Look at him. Look at him.
They owe me money. I will collect. Have them jailed if I have to. They owe me money and I will collect what is due me.
He and I were partners for I don't know how many years. Scrooge was my sole executor, my sole administrator, my sole assign, my sole residuary legatee, my sole friend, and my sole mourner. But Scrooge was not so cut up about the sad event of my death, but that he was an excellent man of business on the very day of my funeral, and solemnized it with an undoubted bargain. He never painted my name out of the window. There it stands, over the window and above the warehouse door, Scrooge and Marley. Sometimes people new to our business call him Scrooge, sometimes they call him Marley. He answers to both names. It's all the same to him. And it's cheaper than painting in a new sign, isn't it? No one has ever stopped him in the streets with gladsome looks to say, "My dear Scrooge, how are you? When will you come to see me?" No beggars ever implored him to bestow a trifle. No children ever asked him what it is o'clock. No man nor woman, not now nor ever in his life, inquired the way to such and such a place. But what does Scrooge care of any of this? It is the very thing he likes, to edge his way along the crowded paths of life, wanting all human sympathy to keep its distance. Oh, the bell tolls, and I must take my leave. You must stay a while with Scrooge and watch him play out his Scroogey life. It is now the story. The once upon a time, Scrooge in his counting house, where else? Christmas Eve, and Scrooge is busy in his counting house. It is cold, bleak, biting weather outside, foggy withal. And if you listen closely, you can hear the people in the court go wheezing up and down, beating their hands upon their breasts, and stamping their feet on the pavement stones to warm them. Only three, and quite dark outside already. It has not been light all day this day.
That's it? Yes, sir.
Turn off that music.
Yes.
What's the meaning of it?
It's almost Christmas Day, sir. So I thought I might brighten up the room a bit.
Get back to work.
Yes, sir. Oh, it's been a crying.
That's it?
Yes, sir.
What are you doing now?
It is bitter cold in here, sir. I just thought it might be heating up the room a bit.
Take a blanket. Get back to work.
Yes,
no.
Sir.
Oh.
And I'm sorry, too.
Don't say it, Cratchit, I warn you.
Sir.
Cratchit.
Very
well. Merry Christmas.
It was old now, and nobody lived in it but Scrooge. The fog and frost so frequently hung around the black old gateway of the house that it seemed as if Mother Nature sat weeping on the front house step.
It is a fact that Scrooge had less of what is called superstition about him than any other that you or I have ever encountered. Nevertheless, on this very night, as he made his way up the lonely dark staircase,
his blood felt a terrible sensation to which it had been a stranger for many years.
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
Can you sit down?
Oh, I can do much more than that, Ebenezer. I'm a ghost, but I'm here. You're not dreaming.
Something is affecting my senses. I must be sick and food poisoning.
Are you trying to make a joke? It's not like you.
Why are you bothering me?
You think that I'm real, Ebenezer? I've been tethered since my death, and like the witches warned Macbeth, I will share what I have learned since my last breath. Though I've traveled far and wide, since in life I can sigh, let's see what we can change before your death. In life, I would be shamed out of every selfish game. Now I'm sent to wander earth like Cain. Link by link, yard by yard, every choice cold and odd. Now I know the meaning of shame. Do you see these chains? All these locks that have no keys? When your weight and length of the chains you bear. It resembles mine 7 Christmas Eves ago, but now...
Speak comfort to me, Jacob.
I have none to give. No amount of revenge can fix the opportunities I've missed in life.
But you were always a good businessman.
Business should be tolerance and charity and benevolence, and documents through self-pleasure. Till Christmas time I'm weary. Heed my words, for my stay is not endless.
New York City's chains.
Oh, these locks that have no keys. When your eyes close for the last time,
you'll have your own to be your least.
Hear me, Ebenezer, for my time is nearly gone. I don't know how I appeared here tonight. I'm just sitting beside you unseen, night after night. But you have a chance and hope of escaping my fate.
You always were a good friend to me, Jacob.
You will be haunted by 3 spirits.
That's the chance and hope. I think I'd rather not.
Tonight at 1, the first ghost comes. Tomorrow night, the 2nd, then 3rd. For your sake, Ebenezer, remember my every word.
It is impossible. Was it a dream or not? Are you the spirit who was told about?
I am.
Well, who are you?
I am the ghost of Christmas past.
Long past?
No, your past. And now, please see another Christmas. Do you know this place, Ebenezer?
Know it? I interned here.
0.046, 7 times. 8,003.
Yes, yes.
Plus the additional fee of 94.
Got it all written down. For reference.
Richard Wilkins and Ebenezer Scrooge. The hour points to 7. We've got no time to lose. No more work tonight, boys. Tonight is Christmas Eve. Let's have the curtains off so everyone can see.
It's Spencer Collider again. Oh,
spirit,
it's all
Christmas! It's the end, you all know it's how it is. You know the end, you find in the stanza. The very people hold to the end of your host in the stanza. Leave an empty room for one. Look around you with an orchestra of mine. A flurry of cacophony, this destiny is mine. The fate can be so light.
Make those people so happy.
Didn't do much.
I wish I could be more like her, Richard.
You're not far off, Ebenezer. You know she'll hire you full time soon.
It's not just that. It's her parties with the food and the music and the dancing.
And her neighbor, Bill. So that's why I've been around here all this time, gazing out the window.
Even then, you held her in such high esteem. All she did was spend money on a party, and she deserves this praise?
It wasn't that, Spirit. She had the power to make us happy or unhappy, to make every workday easy or stressful, pleasant or horrible. Her power was in her words and in her looks, and things so slight and insignificant that it'd be impossible to add and count them all up. The happiness she gave us was worth the fortune.
What's the matter?
Nothing. I just wish I could have a word with my clerk, Beth Cratchit. That's all.
My time grows short. Quickly! It doesn't matter. I've been replaced by something that will make you happier, and you will be happy with it, so I have no regrets.
Replaced by who?
You fear the world too much, Ebenezer. When you used to have such noble dreams, but you've forgotten them all one by one, all you want is gain.
I've grown up. My priorities have changed, but my feelings towards you are the same.
Are they? When we met you, we didn't care about money, and we were so content, but you are changed entirely. When we met, you were another man.
I was a child. Have I ever wanted to be with anyone other than you, Belle?
No, but if we met today, would you still want me?
What does it matter? You've made up your mind.
I have. Your heart's not broken. You need not make those eyes at me. I know you're hurting now. Give it time and you will be awake again.
Tonight, then I am ready for it.
Yes! That's the spirit! Hey,
See what I did there? Spirit. Gosh, I am a riot. This is gonna be fun. All right, give me your hand. Come on, give me your hand. There we go. One, and two, and...
I will. Where are we? Who is this man?
Shh, he's getting to the best part.
The children were nestled all snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there rose such a clatter, I sprang from the bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters, and threw up the sash.
Grandpa, Grandpa, Mama's coming!
Hide me!
No!
No, she'll never know, Grandpa.
Good. Now don't let Penny or you give it away.
Shh, she's coming.
You boys were so good.
Oliver, thank you again for coming with Tim and I to church. We love having you with us. You're welcome to stay for dinner.
Thank you, ma'am, but I have to be getting home. My mother is expecting me.
Of course. Well, it is Christmas after all. No. Tim, say goodbye to Oliver.
Merry Christmas.
So, what have you done with Grandpa?
He left.
No.
He left.
He went out.
Went out?
He said he needed
to take a walk.
He said he needed to take a walk. He left you all here to fend for yourselves?
Yes.
Oh, well, that doesn't sound like Grandpa, but no matter, it just means more dessert for all of us.
Ta-da! I was under the sheets.
Oh, I'm under the shop. Here I was thinking we had a brand new lumpy lamp in our living room.
Gotcha!
Well, now that we found Grandpa, thank goodness. Girls, will you take Tim and go and get ready for dinner? Penelope, don't forget to wash your hands. And Belinda, please don't lick the icing off the cake.
I won't, Mama.
Oh, okay.
She never said I couldn't. That's not fair, Penny.
And how did little Tim behave in church?
Good as gold and better. He gets so thoughtful sometimes. I know he has Oliver, but he sits so much alone that he thinks the strangest things you've ever heard. He told us, coming home from church, that he hoped people saw him, that it might be pleasant for them to remember on Christmas Day, who made lame beggars walk and blind men see. Dad, I think he's getting stronger. I really do.
We made cocoa, Mama.
Cocoa before dinner, Sarah?
It's not technically dessert if it's in a cup. Right, Martha?
Please, Mama?
Please.
I do love cocoa.
Dad, you are as bad as the kids. Okay, it is Christmas after all. Merry Christmas. May God bless us. Yes, Tim, everyone. And let us thank Miss Scrooge, the founder of the feast today.
Founder of the feast indeed. I wish I had her here. I give her a piece of my mind to feast upon, and I hope she chokes on it. Exactly. I'm not thinking to the health of such a stingy, selfish, sourpuss of a woman like Miss Scrooge. You know she is, Roberta. Nobody knows it better than you.
Dad.
Fine. I'll drink to her health for your sake and the day's sake, but not for hers. Merry Christmas to her and Happy New Year. I'm sure she'll be very merry just counting all her coins.
He took a child and sat through the midst of them.
Huh? Who said that? Who spoke?
It's the color. It hurts my eyes. That's better. I should want to show your father, you guys, when he comes home, not for the world. It must be near his time.
Past it, Rosa. But I think he's been a bit slow than usual these last few years, Mother.
I've known him to walk,
I've known him to walk with Tiny Tim upon his shoulder very fast indeed.
So have I, Mother. Often.
So have I.
But he was very light to carry, and your father loved him so. There was no trouble. No trouble. Here's your father with the dwarf.
Oh.
Other wife, children. Oh, good to see you all. And you. But look at this sewing. I have no doubt that all your industry will have a quilt to set down upon our knees and churches.
You made the arrangements today, then, Robert?
You. I wish you could have gone. It would have done you good to see how green her face is. But you'll see it often. I promise Timmy that I would walk there on Sunday. My little child.
Oh, Mama.
Forgive you. I saw Mr. Scrooge's nephew, who you know I've met just once before. He was so wonderful to be by. He is the most pleasant-spoken gentleman I've ever met. He said, I'm heartily sorry for what, and heartily sorry for your good wife. If I can be of service to you in any way, here's where I live. He gave me this card.
That's me,
Sam. He looked at me straight in the eye like, and he said to me meaningfully, I pray you come to me, Mr. Cratchit, if you need some help. I pray you do. Now, it wasn't for the sake of anything that he might be able to do for us. Much as for his kind way. But it was as if he had known our Tiny Tim and felt for him.
Sure, he's a good soul.
You'd be sure of it, my dear, if you saw him spoke with him. I shouldn't have obviously surprised if he got paid for the situation.
And then, he just keeps coming and so on, accepting up for himself. Get along with you.
Oh, it's just as likely as not one of these days. Although there's plenty of time for that. But, however, and whenever we part from one another, I am sure that none of us shall get toward Tiny Tim, shall we? Well, this first parting that was among us?
Never,
Father, never. And when we recollect how patient and mild he was, we shall not quarrel easily among ourselves and forget poor Tiny Tim to do it. I am happy. I am very, very happy.
Parasites I so gloated over. Before I draw nearer to that stone to which you point, answer me one question. Are these the shadows of the things that will be? Or the shadows of the things that may be only?
I praise you and heaven and Christmas time.
not torn down. My bed curtains are not all torn down. Here they are, rings, and all they are here. I am here. The shadows of the things that will have been may now be dispelled, Jacob. I know they will be. I know they will be.
My bed. My room. My house. And my pillow and my sheets are still there. I have no idea what to do. I feel as light as a feather, as happy as an angel, as merry as a schoolboy, as giddy as a drunken man. No fog, just sweet golden sunlight. Merry Christmas to everyone and a happy new year to all the world. Oh, Jacob. Jacob Marley, and Christmas time be praised. But is there still time to make amends? Excuse me, what's today?
Huh?
Hello there, please, what day is today?
Well, today is Christmas.
Christmas Day?
Yahoo!
Oh, the spirits, magic must have been all in one night. Tell me, young lady, do you know the market on the next street, the one on the corner?
Of course.
Oh, wonderful young lady, go there and do this for me. Go there and ask to buy the biggest turkey they have left. Oh, and have them put it under Mr. Scrooge's tab. Oh, and do you know where Beth Cratchit's family lives?
I do. I'm in Martha's Girl Scout troop.
Good, good. Wonderful, young lady. Bring it to the Cratchit house in roughly half an hour, and I'll have a $50 bill waiting for you.
Of course. Thank you.
Time for my best clothes.
I'm not telling you. He has to find a
turkey. Yeah, I know. By the time Ebenezer Scrooge emerged from his house, all the people were pouring forth. And Scrooge delighted everyone. Fantastic spot.
My dear, dear friend, please tell me, sir, how are you? Lovely madame, have a caller ready too. This hair will find, when will you come to see me? Let's find a way to pay your loan without a fee.
You hear the sound you're making, very deep, very deep, so very low. La 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 la.
Oh, ladies and ladies, please, wait a moment. I sincerely hope you're able to get your badges, but just in case, I figured this might help.
Mr. Scrooge, are you serious?
And not a penny less.
We don't know what to say.
Say nothing but Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
You. You glorious, glorious man, you.
May I help you, Miss Scrooge?
I can assure you that you already have, but tell me, sir, do you happen to know what time it is?
Yes, it's half past 11 now.
Perfect.
At 11.
Absolutely perfect. Thank you so much for everything that you do. A very, very Merry Christmas to you.
Happiness is a gift, don't you think? The trick is not to expect it. But the delight in it when it comes. Scrooge found happiness in everywhere she went that day. She went to church and walked about the streets. She hurried me. She went to people hurrying to and fro and patted children on their heads. She looked down into the kitchens of houses and up to the windows. And everything that she saw was the deep sense of pleasure and peace. She couldn't dream of any walk or anything for that matter that could give her so much happiness.
What do you mean by coming in here? What do you mean by coming in here at this hour? What do you mean by coming in here at this hour of the day? A full 18 minutes late, Mr. Cratchit. Hello, sir. Do you hear me?
I am sorry, sir. I am behind my time.
You are? Yes, I certainly think you are. Step this way, sir, if you please.
I'm sorry. It shall be repeated. I was making rather merry yesterday and into the night.
I'll tell you what, Mr. Cratchit. I'm not going to stand for this sort of thing any longer. And therefore, I am about to... raise your salary.
Oh, going to raise your salary and endeavor to assist your struggling family, and we will discuss your affairs this very afternoon over a bowl of smoking bishop. Make up the fires and buy another cold snuggle before you dot another eye. It's too damn cold in this place. We need warmth and cheer. Bob Cratchit, do you hear me? Do you hear me?
Oh, thank you, sir.
My name is Jessica Chase, and I first participated in a Christmas Carol at Artists Exchange in 2013. I was the stage manager for that production. And then in 2015, 2016, and 2017, I directed as well as acted in each production.
Happy holidays, everybody. My name is Bob Ocko. I've been in the Christmas Carol for 16 years, since 2004.
Hello, my name is Mark Carter. I've played many roles in Christmas Carol. I played primarily Scrooge or Marley. Excuse me. I've also played Christmas Present and Old Joe last year. I played Old Joe.
Hi, my name is Lauren Innocelli, and I have participated in Artist Exchange production of Christmas Carol since 2016. And I directed last year's production in 2019.
Hi, my name is Alex Rotella. I was involved with the Black Box at Artists Exchange starting in 2004. I was in Christmas Carol almost every year after that point. Started off playing Jacob Marley. I also played Bob Cratchit, and I played Ebenezer Scrooge in a few productions. The first time we went to the Park Cinema, and also the presentation we did at Rhodes on the Patuxent, and had an absolute blast.
Hi everyone, my name is Shannon Casey, and I'm the director at Artists Exchange.
In 2015 was the first time I directed, and I was nervous and excited and really wanted to do the production justice. One of my first decisions was thinking who would play Scrooge, and we were very fortunate to have Bob Colonna play our Ebenezer Scrooge, who is a Rhode Island theater legend. And this was the first and only time in my current experience of directing the production of placing it in Victorian London. In 2016, we went completely modern and I think made some creative licenses with a script that did pay off and I found to be quite rewarding. Tom Chase played Scrooge that year and our Marley was Jacqueline Marley. I played that and they definitely had more than a business role. And in this production, they had a child together who was Tim, unbeknownst to Scrooge. And here's the creative license. Bob Cratchit and his family did end up adopting Tim. So it was full of unconventional families. We had Starbucks cups. It was definitely a different feel, but a really special production, and I think helped people understand the story and freshened it up a bit. And then in 2017, we were really trying to explore the relationship of Freddie or Fred. Again, we had a female playing the niece instead of the nephew. We were really exploring that relationship with Scrooge and how Freddie never gave up on Scrooge. And also, what was Scrooge's life like as a boy? How did he become the person he was? And for that, we had three different actors playing Scrooge and really tried to pronounce the idea of empathy and how other being in someone else's shoes, you can realize what other people are experiencing. And I also think it was effective in its own way.
Now, when I directed A Christmas Carol in 2019, I wanted to touch upon three key themes: time, charity, and transformation. I also wanted to convey the transcendence of the story. Charles Dickens is one of my favorite authors, and delving into the text, I realized just how poetic and prophetic Dickens was, and that's most likely why the story has been a holiday favorite since it was written. I used some tech elements in order to convey these themes on stage. One of them is actually called a gobo. It's a lighting fixture that can move. So I actually had it hanging right above center stage and it projected a clock onto the floor, and Scrooge and the ghosts would stand in that clock, and anytime Scrooge would travel through time, whether the past, present, or future, the clock would spin and we would see the scenes just changing and developing around Scrooge and the ghosts. I also had women play multiple roles that would typically have been cast as men because I wanted to show the depth of Dickens' characters. So I had my dear friend Rhiannon Annan play Bobby Cratchit. My other dear friend Meg Taylor Roth played my Scrooge. I played Marley and Fezziwig as well, because Dickens was such an incredible writer and artist that his characters and their crises and pain and suffering aren't necessarily representative of gender. It could truly be anyone. So sort of playing with gender on stage with these roles was able to show the depth and truthfulness behind Dickens' characters.
Actually, my favorite role to play would probably be the narrator, because not only he was telling the story, but he's also interactively involved in the same scenes he was describing. That's actually really neat. I like to look back at Nephew Fred, if you will. Since I have played Nephew Fred from 2008, 2009, 2010, also 2013. So that was 4 years. So I had to change his personality, if you will. Like, 1 year he was like open and cheerful, the other year he was persuasive, he was sympathetic. In 2013, I combined both personalities to make him an interesting character. The same thing also applied to Bob Cratchit, because I played him twice in 2005 and 2016. So he was a family man, he also adopted his very first child.
I played Ebenezer Scrooge a few times in Christmas Carol for Artists Exchange, and it was an honor and an absolute privilege every time. The show is challenging. It's not without its difficulty, but it's some of the most fun that I've ever had. You really want to take the audience on that journey with you. And for Ebenezer, you start off in a place where the audience doesn't particularly like him in the beginning. He's hateful and he's rough. And by the end of the show, hopefully, they can feel that holiday cheer and that joy and see what an example of that he is. And that's a really nice arc that Charles Dickens creates. He also creates an incredible world where you get to play with things for me, like being a younger man, playing an older man, which was really fun to get that physicality and sort of his cold, wiry, stiff nature and turn that into something that's really fun and vibrant at the end, although he still is an old man. Also, you get to play with an English dialect, which is always fun, and it's a period piece, so you get to travel back in time a little bit and see something different when you're sitting there in the audience watching the show. And for me, it was just really important that we grounded it and we made sure people were invested in the story so they could go on that journey with us and hopefully leave the theater ready to celebrate Christmas with their family and have that spirit deep in their heart.
Marley is a real catharsis, you know. I always did want to play him. You know, I thought he was the scariest ghost. You know, he was always the scariest one. You know, but that's the weak Scrooge up, you know. That's to make, like, okay, this is what's going to happen to you now. You know, Marley is a lost soul. You know, it's kind of, that's the way Charles Dickens seems to have written him. But, I've always wondered, well, okay, now that Marley's completed this mission, what's going to happen with him? You know, you can, again, Marley's kind of a catharsis. You can sort of yell and scream, you know, business! Mankind was my business, you know. But he gets that out of his system. He needs to do that. But Scrooge is kind of on the ropes, you know. He smartens up as time goes on. You know, he's not really in control, where Marley is kind of in control, but he's in cahoots with all the other spirits. I think he does it with Scrooge because he had an actual friendship with him, you know, as much of a friend as you could be to Scrooge, you know. Behind closed doors, I think it broke Scrooge's heart when he died. A lot of Marley, you know, a lot of Scrooge died along with him. But Scrooge is a kind of, to me, I think, anyway, I mean, if I were to be asked, he's kind of like a dying a slow death. From the time he loses Belle, that's the first blow, and the good spirit of Scrooge is dying a slow death, very slow, like, you know, interminably slow, you know, and before, you know, Scrooge actually physically dies, and maybe Marley knows, because he's a supernatural being, though, that Scrooge's end is near, you know, he wants to make the best life for Scrooge that he possibly can.
There are so many beautiful messages in The Christmas Carol, but one in particular is actually a quote from another Dickens story, but rings true with A Christmas Carol, and I wrote it into the Marley scene with Scrooge. And the quote is, "No one is useless in this world who lightens the burdens of another." And I think Scrooge, with all of his pain and heartbreak within his past, felt as though he had nothing to offer the world because the world had offered nothing to him. And I think that a lot of times people don't truly see their own worth and what they can contribute because we so often look at things monetarily or materialistically. And a lot of times that's not what people need. People need kindness and patience and love, and that message is what I always take from A Christmas Carol.
Christmas is joy and celebrating and, you know, getting time to spend with the people that you love, and Christmas Carol brings all of those things together.
The absolute joy of working at the Artist Exchange were the folks. They are some of the most talented, kindest, most loving, generous people you could ever meet. And that's what made the production so special. Christmas Carol is one of those shows where you can throw a lot of bells and whistles at it. Big, expensive costumes, lavish sets, props. And although you do that, it doesn't really bring much more to the show. Unless you have a lot of heart. And that's what makes the production at Artist Exchange different is the heart. And that heart is the folks. Once they start to roll in the theater and the Christmas music starts to play, it's a feeling like no other. And that is the love and the soul of all the folks at Artist Exchange. It's absolutely incredible. And for me, there is no production of A Christmas Carol like it.
I would probably believe that the most important message would be is that there are always second chances. For a person to turn around and change their attitude and have an open heart during the holiday season, especially throughout the year as well. There are a couple of things of why I like working at Artist Exchange. For one, I love working with the people there, especially since I'm a people person and also a team member. Everyone there is really nice, and I get to tell you that they really helped me quite a lot along the way when I work.
The best thing about working with Artist Exchange is the people. Hands down, no contest, 100% the people. I have found a family in this organization that I wouldn't trade for the world, and I look forward to every moment spent with them on stage and off stage, and what Artist Exchange does throughout the entire calendar year, not just the holidays, is beautiful and inclusive and one of a kind. I'm eternally grateful to have been embraced by Artist Exchange the way that I have, and I love them.
The last thing I want to say about Artist Exchange and what makes it so special is that it's truly inclusive. It, I think, is the only organization, at least that I am aware of, that really gives people of all abilities the chance to be creative, the chance to create, the chance to come together. And that is so remarkable, so special. And I will keep coming back to perform and create and love with Artist Exchange primarily because of that. So, thank you.
I'd just like to say a very Merry Christmas to everyone and a Happy New Year. And to quote our favorite Tiny Tim, God bless us, everyone.